The message is titled Useful Faith from James chapter 2, 18 through 20. You've heard of the running of the bulls at Pamplona, Spain. Let me tell you something about that. Every year, revelers from around the world head to Pamplona, Spain, to take part in the running of the bulls. The running of the bulls is something that was glorified by a book written by Ernest Hemingway in 1926, titled The Sun Also Rises. The festival at Pamplona is a heady 9-day mix of partying and adrenaline chasing. It draws hundreds of thousands of people from around the world to Pamplona, which is a city of about 300,000 people. 15 people have been killed in the bull runs since records have been kept, dating back to 1911. The most recent death occurred 5 years ago when a Spanish man was gored by one of the bulls. Bill Hillman, who's pictured on the ground in the picture, and he has the horn of that bull in his right thigh. Bill Hillman is a 32-year-old Chicago-based journalist, and he's an expert on this event. He even co-authored a book subtitled How to Survive the Bulls of Pamplona. Makes you wonder, doesn't it, about his expertise. But on July 3rd, 2014, just knowing about bull running, even knowing enough to write an instruction manual on bull running, wasn't enough. A 1,320-pound fighting bull named Brevito, you see him in the picture, lagged behind the pack just before entering the city's bull ring at the end of a rain-slicked run in the annual festival. At the opportune time, Brevito gored Bill Hillman, the author of this instruction manual, in the right thigh, and he also gored a 35-year-old Spanish man in the chest. Both men recovered, but the co-author of Hillman's book told the New York Times, "We will probably need to update the book." Dear friends, we often know more about a subject than we practice. It was true for Bill Hillman, and it's true for men and women of faith in Jesus Christ. We tend to know more about the Bible than we practice. Let's see what James has to say about practicing God's word. So would you turn with me then to the passage in James chapter 2, and I'll have it on the screen as well. James said, "But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without the works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one, you do well. The demons also believe and shudder. But are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow, that faith without works is useless?" I'd like to nail this truth down for us today. That is, useful faith should be obvious in our daily lives. A useful kind of faith should be obvious as people look at our daily lives. Notice, first of all, that we demonstrate genuine faith through a changed life. How do people around us know that our faith is real? It's by a changed life that we live from day to day. Notice that a saving kind of faith and a changed life go together. It's pretty easy to say that I have faith. It's much more difficult to have a changed life that shows, proves that my faith is indeed the genuine article. Saving faith and changed lives go together. Remember, we are saved by faith alone. It's not our good works. It's not that I'm a good person that will one day allow me to enter God's presence in heaven. My works will never be sufficient. I'll never be good enough in myself, in what I'm able to do in my own strength to enter God's presence in heaven. We are saved by faith alone. That is, by putting our complete trust in the finished work that Jesus accomplished on the cross 2,000 years ago. It's only by trusting what he has done for me that I am saved for eternity. I'm thankful that Maria Layton put her trust in that message that Jesus died for her on the cross, that it's not her own goodness, even though she was a beautiful person, a good person. It was not her goodness that allowed her to enter God's presence on Thursday morning. It was her relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. We are saved by faith, by trust alone. Remember, it's really as simple as the ABCs of faith. What does the A stand for in the ABCs of saving faith? I need to admit that I have a sin problem. Remember, the Bible tells us that we were all born into the world as sinners. And if you've raised children, you know that you didn't have to train them to be disobedient. You didn't have to train them to pursue their own things. You didn't have to teach them how to be a good sinner. That came naturally to them, didn't it? We tried to, you know, get them squared away and to head down the right path, but they were born into sin. So the first thing, A, we need to admit that I'm a sinner. Paul the Apostle said in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned. All is really an inclusive word, isn't it? For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And then three chapters later in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, Paul said, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, what he did on the cross. I need to admit that I'm a sinner. And then the B is to what? Believe. Thank you. Believe. We simply need to believe in Jesus and his finished work on the cross. Can you say John 3:16? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. What a simple message. Even a young child can understand that simple message. But what is it to believe? I think John clarifies in his gospel, John 1:12, what it means to believe. When he says in John 1:12, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become the children of God, even to those who believe in his name. Believing means that I believe to the extent of receiving. It's not enough just to believe the facts in my head that Jesus died on a cross, that he was buried, and that he rose again, but I must receive that message personally. Have you done that, dear friend? Have you received this simple message of the good news personally? I must believe to the point of receiving Jesus as my Savior. So A is admit that I'm a sinner. B is to believe in Jesus and his finished work on the cross. C is to confess. Confess that Jesus is my Lord. That shouldn't be a secret to my family or to my friends, to the people I work with. I shouldn't be a secret agent for the Lord. In a sense, I need to confess him openly as my Savior. Paul talked about this in Romans 10:9-10, when he said, but if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. One of the great reasons that the Lord has instituted water baptism is that we might confess in a public setting that we are now following Jesus as our Savior and Lord. So I really encourage any person who put their trust in Jesus to be baptized in water so that they can make that public confession to their family and friends. So we are saved by faith alone. It's as simple as A, B, C. But what James is talking about in James chapter 2 is that if we've truly entered into that relationship personally with Jesus, there should be some change that happens in my life. I'm not who I was before I asked Jesus to be my Savior. My life is in the process of change because now Jesus is my Savior. He's given me His Holy Spirit to live within me, to give me the power to live a Christian life. A changed life follows our new life in Christ. Do you remember what Paul said in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10? Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. These are important verses. Hope you'll mark them, highlight them. Paul said in Ephesians 2, 8, For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. But then in verse 10, he says, For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, for good works, which God prepared beforehand, so that we would walk in them. We're not saved by works. We can never do anything good enough to merit salvation. But works should follow. A changed life should follow my faith in Christ. So back in James chapter 2, verse 18, James says, But someone may well say, You have faith, and I have works. Remember, most of the readers of this letter that James has written initially were Jewish believers. They had a Jewish background. And good works were vitally important to Jewish people. Keeping the law as best they could was vitally important for their well-being, their relationship with God. But Scripture is clear that only genuine faith saves. Paul said in Romans 3:28, For we maintain that a man is justified by faith, that is declared right with God, by faith, apart from works of the law. It's not by any works of the law, trying to keep the Ten Commandments. Saving faith, however, is revealed, shown, proved through our changed lives. James is concerned here with how we make our faith known to others. How do we make our faith known to those around us? He says, Show me your faith. Show me your faith. The word show in this verse means to make it known. Demonstrate your faith. Give evidence of your faith. Give proof that you have faith in Jesus. Genuine faith is impossible to prove apart from a changed life. We can talk until we're blue in the face about saving faith, but unless there's some change, it's very difficult, it's impossible to show, to prove that we have genuine faith in Christ. Genuine faith is revealed through the living out of our faith day by day. Do you remember what Jesus said in John 13:35? Jesus said, By this all men will know that you are my disciples, that you're my followers, if you have love for one another. One of the proofs that I know Jesus is that I have love for those around me. It's not all about me, but there are others that God has placed in my life. I need to love them, give myself in encouraging them. And then Paul said in Galatians 5:6, I love this verse. You might want to mark it down as an important verse to remember. Galatians 5:6, Paul says, for in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision means anything, but faith working through love. Faith working through love is what's important. It's not keeping these commandments, as the Jews were concerned about circumcised or not. It's not that. It's faith working through love. So we need to remember the balance as God's people, the balance that James brings in this little epistle, this little letter, and that is saving faith is our possession by trusting in what Jesus accomplished on the cross. But trusting in the finished work then goes on to demonstrate the genuineness of our faith by living it out from day to day. So again, remember this theme statement. Useful faith, living faith, should be obvious in our daily lives. Secondly, from verse 19, notice that even the demonic spirits believe in the oneness of God. Even Satan and the fallen angels, these demonic spirits, believe in the oneness of God. Did you see what James says in verse 19? He said, you believe that God is one. You do well. The demons also believe and shudder. They believe it so much that the hair on the back of their necks bristles up at the very name of Jesus. Jewish people, many of these James is writing to in this letter, believed in the oneness of God, even under Judaism, before they came to faith in Jesus Christ, because the basic confession of faith for the Jewish person is found in the Shema of Israel. And we see it there at the bottom of the screen, Shema Yisrael, the Shema of Israel. It literally means hear, H-E-A-R, hear, O Israel. The Shema of Israel is recited morning and evening by a good Jewish person. This is a familiar verse to a good Jew. Deuteronomy 6:4, hear, O Israel, Shema Yisrael, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. This verse in Deuteronomy stresses the uniqueness of their God. It could be translated in Deuteronomy 6:4, the Lord, that is Yahweh, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. There's no other God in all of creation. It's the Lord alone. But saving belief is more than just giving assent to a doctrinal statement. It's more than reciting the Shema morning and evening, this true statement. Saving faith requires a personal trust in that one unique God, as John 1:12 reminds us that we need to receive Him personally. You believe that God is one. The demons also believe. The word believe in verse 19 is a word that means to think to be true, to acknowledge a fact. It could refer to an intellectual kind of faith, something I believe up here in the upper story. It's an intellectual kind of understanding. James says, if you believe that God is one, you do well. You are correct. You're right. You've got that doctrine nailed down. But then he points out that even the demonic spirits believe this doctrinal statement that God alone is God, that he alone is creator of all things. The demonic spirits also believe in the oneness of God. They could recite the Shema of Israel, believing it to be true. But it's an intellectual belief that demonic spirits have. It's not possessing a saving kind of faith, certainly. James says that the demons also believe this statement about God, that he is one, and they shudder at that truth. Remember, the demons are fallen angels. A third of the angels of heaven fell with Lucifer when he rebelled against God and wanted to be like the Most High God. A third of the angels followed him, and they became fallen angels or demonic spirits. Remember, Satan is the ruler of the demons. Matthew 12, 24 points that out clearly. Demons do the work of Satan. Demons know who Jesus is. In Mark 1:24, for instance, if you'd like to turn over to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verse 24. Where it says this, saying, "What business do we have with each other, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Jesus was speaking to one of the demons. They knew that he is the Holy One of God. The demons know that they are doomed for all of eternity, according to Matthew 8, 29. They also have a system of doctrine, a belief system, according to Paul's letter to Timothy, 1 Timothy 4, 1 through 3, doctrines of demons. Demons attempt to thwart the purposes of God. They have an intellectual faith in God. In fact, that faith is so strong that they shudder at the truth of who he is. The word shudder, used only here in all of the New Testament, means to bristle or stiffen, to stand up, to be struck with extreme fear, or to be horrified. You ever seen a cat bristle up? That's sort of what the demonic spirits do when they hear about Jesus. They shudder. The hair on the back of their necks stands up. So it's not an intellectual faith that saves us. It's different than a saving faith. Intellectual faith believes facts. Saving faith takes action based on the facts. Saving faith personally receives God's gift of grace. We need to remember that useful faith should be obvious in our daily lives. And then finally, from verse 20, faith that is devoid of works is useless or dead. James asks the question, "But are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow? Do you have a desire to acknowledge these things, you foolish fellow?" The word foolish means to have a complete lack of understanding, a complete lack of insight into the truths that James is sharing here. Do you have a desire to acknowledge that faith without works is useless? Intellectual faith, the conviction of the truth of anything, without acting on it personally, is useless. And the word useless means ineffective, not accomplishing anything. Dear friends, our lives should be different after coming to Christ by faith. If there is no difference in my life after praying a prayer to receive Jesus, I need to reevaluate my relationship to him. We must conclude that a useful faith should be obvious in our daily lives. I have a couple of application points. One is to take your spiritual temperature during this week. How am I doing? How is my spiritual temperature? I believe there are a couple of passages that can help take that temperature. One is Galatians 5, 16 to 25, where Paul talks about the deeds of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit. If I'm characterized my life by the deeds of the flesh, I need to reevaluate and get right with him. Another important passage is 2 Peter 1, 3 through 11, where James Peter reminds us that we need to have a growing faith, adding to our faith the characteristics of Christ. So we need to ask, am I walking in the Spirit? Am I growing in Christian character? Another application would be to pray for an opportunity to share the simple message of the good news concerning saving faith. These ABCs, admit, believe, confess. Pray specifically and fervently for those family members, friends, whoever it might be, for an opportunity to share the good news with them. Let me conclude with a word from General William Booth of the Salvation Army. He spoke these words in a founder's message to some soldiers of the Salvation Army. William Booth said, "Faith and works should travel side by side, step answering to step, like the legs of men walking, first faith and then works, and then faith again, and then works again, until you can scarcely distinguish which is one and which is the other. Faith and works must go together. They cannot be separated. If we simply have an intellectual kind of faith, we're no different than the demonic spirits." Remember, useful faith should be obvious in our daily lives.